Capitalism means that in a society there is always going to be people who have large amounts of ownership and own large portions of business and assets. So the question in this debate is not whether or not we think this is correct, but what is the kind of person that we want in this position? Who is the best person to hold this sort of power, and who will have the least impact or the most positive, will have the most positive effect on the community? That's the question that we as the Affirmative will be propping, and we will be saying that Mr. Burns, in the situation of the Springfield universe, is by far and away the best person to be in this position. So today my argument will have two main points. The first being that Mr. Burns's attributes provide development opportunities where others are unlikely to achieve these goals. And then secondly, how Mr. Burns's interests are sort of general, generic corporate ones, and by his very nature, him being in that position is by far and away the most beneficial situation for Springfield. So, before I move on to my first argument, I would just like to start off by characterising what Springfield is. What is this world in which this debate is based? So, Springfield is, a small town in Illinois in the United States. It's a pretty backwater area. It's full of pretty lower educated people. There's not a lot of employment opportunities. There's no major resources, no major natural resources in the town. There's no real major primary industries outside those operated by Mr. Burns. And therefore, it can be insinuated that the town would far likely be in a far worse economic situation if it were not for the employment opportunities offered by Mr. Burns' corporations, especially the power plant. But Mr. Burns' actions have been responsible for a lot of the very recent economic development within Springfield. And this is for a number of reasons. Firstly, his capital base. Now, Forbes, according to Wikipedia, estimates that Mr. Burns is worth something in the vicinity of $1.3 billion. And in the show, it's shown that he's like really, really loose with his money. He likes to spend a lot. And like I think pretty standard economic policy here is that if you are spending that sort of money in the community, you're going to be stimulating economic growth. And that is, no doubt, a positive. Now, the second component of this is that Mr. Burns is a really skilled businessman. And this is obviously beneficial because someone who is a skilled businessman is able to grow a company fast. I mean, this can be seen quite easily in real-world examples like Apple, where you have someone who is a really sophisticated businessman leading the company and able to generate growth. And obviously, the obvious byproduct of this growth is more jobs in Springfield, and this is a clear benefit to the community, and that's something that we as the Affirmative support. And then a secondary mechanism to this is that not only does it provide jobs, but the businesses that Mr. Burns are invested in, including power supply, is something that's really integral to the community. And so in providing those services, he also provides secondary happiness and comfort. Happiness and comfort features, and that's something that's obviously a positive. And then a third sort of point about his impact on the development of Springfield is that unlike his sort of stringent business development, he's quite loose in his personal dealings. He's known to have like just given away businesses in bets or that sort of thing. So, you know, he'll start a company, start from scratch, grow it all the way up, employ people in Springfield, then lose it, and then sort of straight away rebuild another one. And that's a pattern that has apparently been going on throughout his life. And that means that in a feature that is very unique to Mr. Burns as a businessman, he has been starting multiple companies because he just has a habit of losing them. And I think it can be reasonably assumed that some of these businesses, at least in a limited capacity, remain in Springfield as employers. So this legacy of what he has done still remains. And then he's starting another company. And this is a benefit that only Mr. Burns' sort of self-destructive attitudes, I suppose, would be able to provide. Yes, I'll take
it. In his time owning the power plant, Mr. Burns has had to go bankrupt under his control and has also sold it to Germans. Were those good decisions for businesses
bankrupt? They could have been, yeah. It doesn't mean that he necessarily lost jobs. If he's got $1.3 billion of capital and he's able to bail it out, that's okay. We're not talking here about whether or not his decisions were great for Mr. Burns' personal finances. We're talking about whether or not his decisions worked for the community, and I think in that situation, perhaps selling to Germans did work all right. Before I start my second argument, I'd just like to preface that the Springfield population, perhaps, is not up to the same standard as people who live in a larger city where perhaps they have a greater exposure to corporate interests and are able to and have a higher quality of education and may be able to resist corporate structures, and also that the political structures that appear to exist in Springfield are not particularly strong and not particularly not particularly impactful in being able to protect the Springfield community from sort of malevolent corporate interests. So, Burns' interests are quite generic corporate ones. It doesn't really matter who would be in charge in that Mr. Burns doesn't have particularly mean, he's not particularly evil, he doesn't want anything that would be beyond what a normal company wants. Most companies will pursue the largest market share that they can gain, and that's not something that's necessarily evil. So it wouldn't matter whether or not it's Mr. Burns in charge, that is something that would be a reality of what's happening.
Still,
yes.
Mr. Burns regularly pays off government employees and safety regulators in order to gain an illegal monopoly. Is that good for business in Springfield?
Not necessarily, that quite clearly shows the political structures in Springfield are not particularly strong. So why is it good that it's Mr. Burns in charge? So he is a caricature of a caricature, essentially, and this means that he's a very obvious face of old money, and this means that he's quite obviously something that can be rallied against. And so it's like different from, say, a corporation being a minority in charge or that sort of thing, so they're able to direct they're able to direct focus away from the company leadership. Someone being in charge like Mr. Burns acts as a really strong figurehead that political capital in Springfield can be built up against and perhaps force some sort of positive change. A second feature that only Mr. Burns has is that he doesn't understand mass media particularly well. And this means he's not very effective at PR. He's not able to drum up political support for, say, different lobbying purposes and that sort of thing. So this means that if he is in charge, it's less likely that some really dodgy legislation will get pushed through because he doesn't have the capability to create the mass marketing scheme effectively to be able to generate public support that will be required. A third sort of idea is that he does like some really crazy shit, right? He's really eccentric in what he does. Sometimes, you know, he tried for some strange reason, he thought it might be funny to walk out the sun. And this means that everyone knows he's a little bit strange. And that so this is something that people can rally against, and he's something that's obviously a figurehead. And the result of this is Springfield is less likely to be captured by corporate interests, because it means that they're quite aware that Mr. Burns is a central character. And the secondary result is that the political capital against Mr. Burns can be formed in a block. And for all these reasons, so proud to propose.